have to hitchhike back, and whatever he got from people in terms of if they put him up for the night or he slept in the car, what, he just lived a very Spartan existence. All he cared about was learning, listening, and playing the guitar.
Hi, I'm Jay Roberts.
And I'm Brandon Bellini.
And welcome to the Howard Roberts Sessions, a video series dedicated to the legacy of my father, H.R.
So come and join us at the campfire while we tell some stories and listen to the music of Howard Roberts, one of the most heard guitar players of all time. We're so thrilled to be able to share his incredible journey with you all. Make sure that you subscribe down below, and that way you'll get all the videos as they come out. Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to the Howard Roberts Sessions. We have another installment of the documentary for you. This is going to be episode 2. And if you haven't seen the first episode, you can check back on our channel. It should be in the playlist there. And this is an awesome installment here.
Yeah, this is actually about the desert years, his upbringing in Phoenix, Arizona in the 30s. In fact, this is the very first time he actually ever plays a guitar. And it's a great story because it starts with a 2x4 and some wire on it. So I think you're going to enjoy it. Howard Roberts' boyhood was typical for a Depression-era child whose family was eking out an existence in the Arizona desert in the early 30s. Times were tough. Families were close, and so many Americans were dedicated and determined to scratch out a dignified living under such oppressive conditions. Driven and committed to playing the guitar, the 7-year-old did his best to build an instrument from a board and baling wire. How could any parent resist a child with such passion? So, on Christmas Day, a young Howard Roberts was presented with an $18 Kalamazoo brand guitar. That Christmas gift officially launched one of the most brilliant and important music careers of the 20th century. Here's his story.
My name is Madeline Roberts, and I'm the daughter of Howard Roberts. And my dad, as did I, came from Phoenix, Arizona. He was born there in 1929 on October 2nd. And his family, his father's side, were farmhands and ranch hands from Llano, Texas. And his mom's side were real tough loggers from a little town in Oregon called Myrtle Point. Piestewapik was, in those days, it was very far out in the desert. It was very isolated, no lights. My grandma and my dad spent a lot of time by themselves there. He was a sickly boy. She was taking care of him, nursing him back to health. And our granddad, Damon Roberts, was quite often on the road doing migratory work, packing fruit and so forth. They were a poor family. They didn't have a lot of means, and he had to spend a lot of time away from home, away from his wife and son. And there were a lot of old mine claims in that part of the valley where miners had gone out and looked for gold, because there'd been a huge gold strike and silver strike in Wickenburg, Arizona, some years before. And there were a lot of miners that would literally shoot you if they found you getting too close to their claim, and you might not even know there was a mine there. And people sort of wandering around the desert at night, drifters, and my grandmother would get very, very concerned about that. And whenever she'd hear a noise at the back screen door, she'd shoot a hole through the back screen door with a double barrel shotgun. And that was her way of dealing with the bad guys. Dad was spent a lot of time in bed, and she educated him by reading him books, Rudyard Kipling, things that had to do with imagination. And he took to that, and he spent a lot of time by himself. And as he got stronger, he was able to do more. He was able to start running around the desert with his dog, and there's a great picture of him holding a, you know, he's got his dog and he's got his walking stick and he's got his hat, and you can tell that he's a real little desert rat. He looks like he's about 12 years old there. And he's just had the whole insouciant attitude. It was really beautiful. When she was pregnant with our dad, she was just hoping that the baby would have some musical ability, and she would play her mandolin on her stomach while he was growing inside of her. But I was very surprised that she said, you know, but actually I hoped your father would be an artist, because he had great artistic talent when he was even as a little boy. And I thought maybe he'd go that way. But instead, at this time when Dad's getting some strength, getting a little stronger, 8 years old, he's riding around with his parents. He's in the back seat of their car, and they're stopped for a light at an intersection in Phoenix called Five Points, where three major roads all come together. And Dad was laying in the back of the car, sort of in a half dream state, as I recall him describing it. And he said, all of a sudden he woke up and says, I've got to play the guitar. And his parents said, what? I've got to play the guitar. And from then on in, he started making these little guitars out of whatever he could make them out of, until they finally got him a guitar. He had one teacher, I think, in Phoenix at the very beginning. And then by the age of 12, 13, he was already playing with country bands, professional country bands. So he was already on his way. He really started knuckling down more about what he was doing. That's when he met a fellow named Howard Heitmeier, who was older, a bit older than him, and was already a very intellectual person who had a lot of sophistication about areas that Dad was interested in.
I think he met me. He said in some article, he saw this guy walking down the street with this big case in some article that he wrote, and he's another guitar player. And that's where it started.
And he also was a fine classical guitar player. So Dad got an awful lot of his inspiration about knuckling down and getting serious about it, and some real cues and help from Howard Heitmeier.
He was probably 17 years old, maybe, and could already play up a storm. Believe me. Because he liked what he liked very early on, and he would go, at that young age, he'd go down to, I still remember, Mays. M-A-Y-S, it was a black club. Yep. They played jazz.
The level of talent and caliber of playing that was going on in Phoenix, Dad used to call it a hotbed of what was happening. While Dad was doing this transition thing, because his relationships with the black community and the black musical community were so good, he would get a lot of sub gigs at this well-known ballroom in Phoenix near the river bottom, and it was called Riverside Ballroom. And it was a big ballroom that the big bands came through and played at. And he, because Ezra Charles had taught him to play bass, he was playing bass with bands like Dizzy Gillespie at the Riverside. And he was sort of like a pre-hippie kid, you know, had this very dedicated life to one thing and one thing only, and he had his boots on that were his muddy boots, and he just was a desert kid. In fact, Dave Grusin said the first time he met Dad, he had a cowboy hat and he had cowboy boots.
He just had, you know, tremendous technique that was just beyond most guitarists.
Oh, he was scary. He was absolutely scary. Talk about speed.
The main thing I remember, you know, or loved about Howard is his playing. And, used to be ridiculous, you know, just way beyond anybody else in those days that I could remember.
So Dad started taking this trek on a regular basis to Los Angeles on the old U.S. Highway 60, Grand Avenue, a straight shot from Phoenix all the way to where the water hits the land. And he would go into LA and go play at the black clubs and try to meet people. And he would have to hitchhike because he didn't have much money for a car. And he would have to hitchhike back, and whatever he got from people in terms of if they put him up for the night or he slept in the car, he just lived a very Spartan existence. All he cared about was learning, listening, and playing the guitar. And then he would come back and he'd say, "No, Mom, I'm not ready to go yet. I'm not ready to go yet. I'm not ready to go yet." When he hit 20, one day he said, "Yeah, I'm ready to go." And that's the move he made and never looked back.
Howard told me that he was trying to decide whether to become a boxer or a guitar player. And he was doing some kind of boxing around town. And Howard loved the artistry of the way this guy boxed. And so he was really into boxing and guitar playing. And so after a gig, Howard played one night. This was in Phoenix. They went to a local park. And the guy says, "Hey, kid, I hear you want to be a boxer." And Howard said, yeah, I want to do that. And he says, "Here, hit me." And he holds up his hand like that. And Howard hit his hand, and the guy says, no, hit me. And Howard hit him. And he says, no. I said, "Hold up your hand." And Howard put his hand up like that. And Howard said, this guy got a look on his face that scared the hell out of him. And he hit him so hard that it hurt, and the ferociousness of the guy's face when he did that convinced Howard that he was going to be a professional guitar player and not a boxer. That's what changed that.
Barney Kessel told me that the first person he heard about Howard from was Dave Brubeck. So he had gotten around, his name had gotten around very quickly. And by the time that the 50s rolled around, he was already moving into Los Angeles and Hollywood, the studios. I've met so many guitar players who would actually come up with me, I think I said this before on the tape, with tears in my eyes, people I've never met before. They find out who my dad is, and they tell me, "You know, your dad changed my life. Those records changed my life." And I've heard that so many times, that there's really something powerful to that story. And I'm so glad this is being done, because people need to know what that was about and how many lives he did change, because there were plenty.